Well, that's wonderful that you liked it. I mean, it changed our life too. It took my life over, sort of grabbed it by the scruff of the neck and kicked it off into the far distance. I had no idea where we were going to end up when we started work on that book, and we just followed the story, really. And, you know, look where it took us.
And, of course, the Messianic Legacy followed soon after, which had some of your reflections on it and got in more into detail on one of the subjects we want to talk about today, which is Jesus' connection with the Zealots. But before we do that, I wanted to note that I think that of all the contributions your books make, the single most powerful concept that I derived is that there are really only two forms of Christianity, the descriptive religion about the dead Jesus, which mass Christianity indoctrinates people in, and then the pure religion of the living Jesus, which, as you note, can only come from within. So I wondered if we could begin there, Michael, with some of your thoughts on that concept of the true, pure religion of the living Jesus.
Well, this is the whole point of the book, The Jesus Papers, and I'm profoundly grateful that you've honed into it so quickly. I mean, this is the 1500 years of cover-up that I'm talking about, that in the 4th century they created this theological concept of Jesus. They made him into a god, a pagan god, effectively. And by doing this, they silenced the man underneath. And if you look at the man underneath, you find someone who's teaching in an extraordinary spiritual system which has no gender distinctions. I mean, it's open to men and women. There's none of this nonsense of a male-dominated apostolic succession. None of that's there. He's not claiming to be God. He's saying that everybody has within them some divinity and that they can discover that themselves. It's experiential, it's individual, it's mystical, it's initiatory. It has to do with each man and woman approaching, finding, and experiencing divinity for themselves. And by doing this, though he's working in a Jewish tradition, this tradition of this individual and experiential approach to spirituality, this tradition goes right across the ancient world. We find it in Egypt, Greece, Rome, and that's why in my book I go on a 2 or 3 chapter excursion, taking the reader on a journey through these other systems, so that the reader can become familiar with the techniques and the metaphors used to describe it, because of course the events, this kind of experience is really beyond the capabilities of language to express it.
That's right, and that's one of the things I so appreciated, especially when you took us to Egypt, because you noted that one of the key things that you have to do when you're in the temples is actually feel them and embrace them. And I thought that was such a key statement. So why don't we talk about that just for a moment? Because very often when you see depictions of Jesus and Mary Magdalene, they're these holier than thou kind of depictions and often very solemn. They never show them in what I would suggest is their native habitat, the temples of Egypt, of Iran and Iraq even, and other places. So let's talk about what that temple experience must have been like.
Well, the point of the temples, I mean, what's the point of any religion? It's to guide or aid people towards experiencing divinity for themselves. But what so often happens is the religion starts getting more interested in sustaining its own organization. But the temples, the beauty of the temples was, especially in ancient Egypt and you know, many other countries, is that they were there, they existed primarily to serve what was called Ma'at in Egypt, which is this universal harmony. And the idea was that by maintaining a relationship between this world and the next world, or which the Egyptians called the Duat, the far world, which is this world of the spiritual beings, this world of divinity, by maintaining the constant harmonious relationship between these two worlds, our world and that world, then the harmony of the universe was maintained. And so the whole point of the priesthood, of the temples, was to maintain this harmony, to constantly keep these two worlds in conjunction with each other and in balance with each other. And of course, they had techniques, as I explain in the book, for moving from one world to the other and coming back again. In a sense, learning about the world of the dead before they died. This is what initiation was all about. And this is what I believe Jesus was teaching, his message of love, forgiveness, and compassion was how one could live within the world. But he was also teaching an inner teaching, which was how to move to the world, to the divine world itself. And he called this the kingdom of God. And the question I ask in the book is, what does he mean when he says, or when he terms something, moving to the kingdom of God, or understanding the kingdom of God? And this is something I'm exploring.
And so what do you think the kingdom of heaven or the kingdom of God was in their conception?
It's his metaphor for this divine world, which is possible to move to if you have the key. It's the same world that the Romans called the Elysian Fields, that the Greeks called Hades, that the Egyptians called the Duat, the far world. It's the world, the spiritual world, which lies behind the appearances of this world, the world that we live in, the world that we move in. And it's the world that after death one moves to. Let's just call it the other world. It's an easy sort of concept, I think, for people to understand. And I think that we have this innate longing to know and to travel to this other world. And I think this longing is very much part of our religious impulse. We want to know who we are. We want to know why we are here. We have this longing for this completion, to know both worlds. And I think what happens with religions is they stand between a person and their knowledge of the other world, and it gives them enormous power. And I think that's why a lot of religions don't want people to have the freedom of knowing for themselves this divine world. But certainly Jesus was involved in that. I mean, there's this wonderful quote in the New Testament, on several parts of the New Testament, where he says to his disciples, he gives the parables for the people out there, the public, but he comes back and gives the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven to his disciples. I mean, Matthew 13 is a good example of that. Clear, he has this dual message, this dual teaching.
This is a good episode right here. This is episode 137. I interviewed Jeff Purdy, my homeboy Jeff from the Spartans, from 214. He's a cool dude. But yo, this was a deep ass talk. We talked a lot of shit, and we were kind of, in this talk, we were talking about the Holy Grail and shit like that. You know, Zach's been on that lately. In this talk, it feel like we were hovering over it the whole time. And right after the talk, we started talking more on the internet. And then it was like, yo, the Holy Grail, because we hovered over it and we were talking about bloodlines and shit like that and blah, blah, blah. But then right after we got off the phone, we was like, yo, the Holy Grail, now he showed somebody, said it was the Codex. And it was in the blood. And we were just talking about that. We were like, oh yeah, how did we fucking not mention the Codex? Because that's what, that's what Zack Snyder was talking about. And that's how he put it together in his movies, was the Codex. Because, like, say, the Nazis were looking for the Holy Grail. They were looking for a relic, right? Now, you can tag the Nazis and try to connect them to Zod and his crew. So Zod was looking for the Codex, the actual relic. They were looking for the Codex inside of this Superman spaceship. But the Codex was in his blood. So when the guy found it, he found out it wasn't a relic at all. It was actually encoded in his blood. So that's going to be the secret that unlocks so much more in the coming future of, the bloodline of Jesus Christ and the life of Jesus Christ. And we talk about that in this podcast, but we talked We talk about a lot of shit. You're going to love this podcast, but I'm going to put some more videos in here to help, you know, kind of show what we're talking about a little bit more. And this is going to be like a part one because we were supposed to get Brian Kuhn on the line. We didn't get Brian. He had to do something. And then we tried to get Kojay. Didn't get Kojay. He was busy also. But so we're going to now just make this a part one. And we're going to probably do a part two, maybe even a part three, because this is some deep shit. But also, all of this was started, in my opinion, this was all started with Go Deep episode 134. Go back and listen to it. This is the episode with Ben W. on it, and we kind of talked about that shit with the power of myth. And the power of myth is pretty much all we're talking about right now. So, catch up on your Go Deep. Subscribe to the channel. If you're not already subscribed, subscribe to the channel. And let's get it. Go Deep, episode 137. Yeah, bitch.
You got your hands on Mooney shit? Say what? We gon' get high. I don't give a fuck about that. We a bird anyway. We be taking his packages. We a snitch too.
Hey yo, in Pam's house there was money missing. She was too dumb, had her nose numb, sniffing blow in the kitchen. Her kids never ate, BCWs involved with her. Kids that she never seen, shipped to the Florida. Maxine, dark-skinned, poor-headed bitch, mean. Pins right hand, together they're the coldest fiends. Aw, shit, guess who arrived at the door? It's Mooney the supplier, stone over the door. Bitch, open the door, Maxine, he gon' kill me. Chill, I got a friend cop, girl, you don't know it's beef. Three long kicks, the hinges flew off. Kids screaming, the heavy face slap, blew Maxine head off. It's on in the crib, you wrong for what you did, you gon' pay Pam. Fuck that, boo, kiss your kids, y'all get the fuck in the room. Fuck you, you ain't a real daddy. Next time you see my caddy, don't fucking flag me.
This is where he fucks up at, peep his movement.
Maxine's in the kitchen crying, grits is balling on the side. She had a couple lies, somebody gotta die. Y'all bitches fucked up, smoked up my packages.
Y'all had Mackie shit and Pappy shit. Word to Aunt May, I want mine. Pulled out the nine, get in the tub. He seen the hot iron, pulled the plug out. He stink pin, bought it back to Penny on good times. Vacuum the dollar bill, he sniffed like six. He put his gat down, why he do that? Creeping through the crib was Maxine. Potholder down with the grits. Pam sucking his dick. Maxine outgreened him, screaming, slipped and pissed. He ran in the seeds room, grits down, crying. Aye, with his balls out. He stepped on Clarence, Biggie Smalls album. Boobie, get that nigga. Pam yelling, rip that nigga. Mookie went and got the die out the kitchen. James jumped on Moon, poked him with a screwdriver. Broke the TV, niggas watching Knight Rider.
This is Pam jerking mother house. The same shit going on at her brother house.
You know Mooney's only a $105 wet. He only had $200 worth of shit, and the kids tore his ass up. The C's had a huddle up, F I'm sorry for him. The funny shit when bow-legged Kiki hopped on him. Jumped on him, pigeon-toed Mookie for a die on him. You should have seen his motherfucker's face crying, half dying. They stuck a fork through his nuts. The little girl was happy, she picked her brother up. Quick, pick the window up, Mooney overheard. Right before they threw him off, the nigga said, word?
On the count of three, he landed right in front of the first floor balcony. Blood, brains, splattered. He was dead. And the cops never came. That stable. Can we hear you out?
Hello?
Yo, can you hear me?
Yeah, I hear you. What's up, brother?
Damn right. What's going on, bro?
Nothing at all. Pretty boring day.
Yeah, right. Oh, man. What a day, right?
What a day.
Yeah.
What a day. What a day.
All right.
Are you hyped?
Hell yeah, I'm hyped. Let me introduce you and we can get straight in. This is Go Deep episode 137. My homeboy Jeff Purdy on the line. What's going on, Jeff?
What's up? How you doing, sir?
Pretty good, sir. Pretty exciting day, man. We went trending again. We had Zack Snyder drop his shirt. And now he just dropped a picture of Steppenwolf. What do you feel about all that shit?
Dude, that shirt in itself, man. The hoodie and the shirt, yeah. We got the title of the movie.
Right.
We've got Green Lantern and Martian Manhunter added. Confirmed.
Yep. Right.
Basically.
Right.
And then the back of it makes me feel like this movie was sort of like about us, you know?
Explain. What do you mean?
So let me find out. I want to get it right. The back of the shirt, it says, let me get it right, dude. Since I'm pulling it up, $6,000 has already been raised.
Hell yeah.
In the last 2 hours, less than 2 hours it's been up. Never faced us before, not us united. So to me it feels like it's the movement, it's the people coming together, you know, and we finally come together.
Right.
And now the film is released, showing that the Justice League has come together. So united, you know? It's funny because I said that earlier today on Vero. It was before any of this. Yeah. It was like 10 o'clock in the morning.
Yep, I remember.
You united we stand is what I said on one of your posts. It's brilliant, dude.
Yeah.
In itself, it's a paradox to me. And which I think is so meta because, you know, Flashpoint Paradox.
Right.
Like, the film exists before we did, yet we had to exist so the film does.
Right.
It's unbelievable.
Wow. You're right.
I know. I'm probably giving the movement way too much credit because this is...
No, hell no. You're not. But that's dope what you said.
We've been working our asses off.
Right.
I mean, what Go Deep is this again?
This is episode 137, bro.
137. Ooh, that's close. That's close to 1337, which is leet speak for leet. Elite.
Elite? Oh, yeah. All right. Explain that.
1337 is leet speak. Leet speak is this old man's back in his glory days, being on the internet, we had leet speak where we talked in code. Now they do like OMG and all that.
Right. But, oh, I gotcha.
So 1337 means leet or elite.
Right.
Anyways, nerd stuff there. Let's talk about cool stuff.
You mean like back in the day,
no matter what, right?
Back in the day when you and Epstein was on the computer together, huh?
Damn, dude. I told you I'd slip one day.
But yeah, yep. that's dope what you said about how without the movement it feels like, you know, this movie was made before us, but without us, it wouldn't be completed. That's dope, man. Compound on that.
I mean, this is all about, and plus us coming together, and that's what the whole movie's about, them coming together. So, I mean, there's so many layers in this, and plus you got Flashpoint Paradox, which is another connective tissue to the whole paradoxical ideal
right
behind this whole thing.
Right.
It's super cool, man. It's right. Super cool. It's so meta. It's everything.
Wow. So let's talk about this Steppenwolf picture. What do you feel about that?
Okay, so he released that picture of Steppenwolf holding the mother's box inside the containment contraption that Elias Stone had assembled.
Right.
To contain the mother box.
Right.
Probably some kind of blast shield because he knew it was volatile. Something. And on the box it says 214. And then he says, what is the secret of the Holy Grail?
Correct.
And that's from Excalibur.
Correct.
And the secret of the Holy Grail is the earth and I are the same?
I just heard about the secret of the Holy Grail the other day. Hold on, I have it. I even text Zach the other day when he did that Holy Grail shirt.
Oh, it's so good, man. Anyone who hasn't watched that movie needs to. Excalibur 1981.
Yep. That's the year I was born.
Oh, really?
Hell yeah.
Just a kid. Just a kid, brother.
Man, you're not that much older than me. Let's see.
But he just, I mean, he went at it on Vero today, man, tonight.
Yeah.
Picture just kept talking to fans and just seeing, like, it was almost like an open ask me anything on Reddit or something. It was
right.
It was so cool.
Right. Yeah, that was dope. Putting
together on there. I mean, he didn't draw any lines with anyone. He answered every question.
You know, it's like funny that you get a bunch of these people now, they all texted me after I put out that video yesterday, and they're like, so who is your sources, and why are we tweeting? What do we got to do, and what do we got to get? You know, it's kind of annoying because it's like everybody's thinking that they're going to get an announcement, you know? But if you really look and read between the lines, we did kind of get an announcement today. We got the fucking name of the movie, and we had, mm-hmm. you know, we had the director to basically, you know, double down on something that's not even supposed to exist. You know what I mean? So it's like, damn, you kind of got an announcement today. It's not like we got to get something from Warner Brothers every day, but blah, blah, blah. Or we got to get them to say something. But today, I think, was a real positive day. We went trending and we got Zack Snyder to kind of get involved. What do you think about that?
Well, dude, so first off, everyone looking for answers, you know, we've already had the answers in my book.
Right.
And for me, you know, it was the coffee in front of the Mad About You sign, which kind of said it was coming out in May or whatever. Right. That was just after November 17th.
Right.
And, you know, just because we haven't gotten a confirmation from WB or any of that doesn't mean, I mean, we had almost a million tweets that day, dude.
Right.
Probably a million if you had released the Snyder Cut, right. You know, all those other hashtags that people, that
right.
I even missed up early on.
Right.
But I do it often. Unfortunately, I'm like, that looks right, click. Oh shit, that says released or cinder or,
yeah, that's what I get fucked up, the cinder cut all the time.
it's Twitter's another monster, but we overcame them. We settled with, you know, our mistakes. We dealt with our mistakes, we accepted it, and we got what, 800,000 tweets that day.
Right.
When's the last time you ever saw 800,000 tweets?
Exactly. Not even Trump can get that.
No. Not even his impeachment can get that. Not even world-changing events got that, dude.
Right.
So how are they not listening?
Right.
So we don't need validation. Right. We don't need acceptance or any of that from them. We already got it, dude. Right. I mean, that's solid evidence that they need to release it. Right. So they will.
Right. Right.
Simple as that. And we've got art. We got Instagram people. We got Facebook people. We got Reddit people. That, you know, our Twitter stuff is little compared to all that.
Right.
I think if you've looked at Instagram, they got one of those accounts has like 100,000 followers or something like that.
Yeah. Yeah.
There's no telling. How big we are. Plus, on Twitter, it's like a battleground.
Right.
There's a lot of closeted Snyder Cut fans, right. You know? But they're afraid to either come out and say they want it because they know they'll get attacked by these little ants, you know, that want to show up when you're eating, you know, your picnic. And right. You just got to swat them a couple times. They never stop.
Right.
Just take them all out.
Right. But you know, I always ask.
Jacob.
I always ask why. Why are these ants still fucking with us?
I think it's. You know, I want to get in deep on it and say it's some kind of conspiracy that Jeff Johns is probably conducting behind the scenes with these ants, these bozos. But I don't know. Maybe it's just a way to try to get a starting point, jump off point to start a career as a YouTuber. I don't know.
Right, right. I think that too, but I'm like their determinability. They're so determined, dog. They're like, even today, before we even started tweeting, before our shit even went down, there was people still talking about what am I doing this for? Why do I got to do this over and over and over? You know, like, dude, just chill, man. Just chill. You know, I call them bozos, but now it's kind of like. Shit, it's just, I don't know about too much, but I want somebody to give me the answers to why they're here and what the fuck are they doing, you know?
Yeah, maybe it's worse, because they do have, they are getting information. We know that.
Right.
They say they are anyhow.
Right.
Either it's counter to what Zach says, and they're going off of that, or they actually do have someone.
Yeah.
If they do have someone, then that's some devious shit, whatever they're doing. And I think someone in the chat just said, what about these big YouTubers? Why aren't they saying shit these little guys are saying, you know?
Right, right, right. Big YouTubers like what? Like Dave? Or is that big YouTuber?
Oh, bigger. No, Dave's not that big. And, you know, and I think they've done the worst thing they could if they did want to start a career.
What's that?
They'll turn their back on something noble.
Right, right. Hell yeah.
We've done nothing but good. And the only struggles we've ever had have them, they were playing games with us.
Right.
I think Leonidas earlier said, block all these people that say something otherwise.
Right, right.
And and I retweeted and said, yeah, dude, your doubts will go away and your hope will be refilled, you know? Like,
right.
You need that. And that's exactly the struggle I had last year or the year before, whatever, where I was struggling to, I was listening to these. Can I say fucker?
Yeah, man. Say whatever you want.
I was listening to these fuckers saying this stuff and they were killing my hope.
Right.
And I had all everything but doubt. Like, every day was, like, doubt.
Right.
And then eventually we finally cut ties, you know. And ever since, I've been walking through Twitter like I can stop bullets. Like in the Matrix, you know? I mean, that's it, dude. And you get that confidence level back up. And you know that it's coming out. And you know that what you're doing is speeding up things, you know?
Right.
The hashtag is just speeding things up, making things better.
Right, right.
Like, I think on November 17th, we went from getting the Snyder cut, so I think we were getting it before November 17th happened. I think we went from getting the Snyder cut to getting the 5-arc.
Oh, shit. Yeah?
The 5-part arc. Oh, yeah.
Yeah?
All Without right. a doubt.
Why? Because we did almost 1 million tweets?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think I think that was all negotiation.
Yeah, I think power. So. I think so. Definitely.
I mean, why not? And hey, and if it doesn't happen, well, I'll just do all this shit again.
Right. Right. And that would more explain the shirt today, like the hoodie. Like you said, nothing has never happened. Like, what did you say? They've never seen us before. Something like that, right?
Oh, on the backside?
Yeah.
I'm old. Let me look in this up. It's maybe it's a tab I closed already. Yeah, it's right here. It says, I need to memorize it. Never faced us before, not us united.
Right, right.
Which sounds like a Wonder Woman line from the movie. I can't wait to hear it. I mean, because she's the optimist. We were talking about that in the chat today about... I mean, I was talking about it. Everyone else is like, Jeff's a wacko. But I was talking about Wonder Woman standing in front when she says, shall we? She's standing in front. She's the fucking leader, dude.
Right.
That is... I mean... They're not lined up next to her.
Right.
She is a good 10 feet. She's making the first swing, taking the first blow. She's in this shit.
Right.
And here's two guys behind her.
No, you're right.
Aquaman and Cyborg. And they're like, let's get it. Because right. They got a leader.
Right. Right.
I can't wait, dude. I can't wait for that.
Right, and that's something more like the secret to the Holy Grail, isn't it? About like a the bloodline of Jesus or something like that. And yeah, I think
that was the Grail that Jesus drank from.
Right, right, and they. So I'm reading this thing now, and they said Dan Brown's book, The Da Vinci Code, put it in a different way. According to the book, the Grail is actually a sarcophagus of Mary Magdalene.
Oh, yeah, they did, yeah.
Yeah, you ever heard of that?
Yeah, I watched that movie. It wasn't the same, that she was the actual Holy Grail, and that her cup was like... indicative of a female body part.
Right.
That's what they said. That's it. I mean, it's got, you know, like a significance.
So would that tie into Wonder Woman, like you were just talking? Any?
Oh, shit. Now you're... Yeah, I was going to blow it off, but now you got... I don't know, man. You caught me off guard. What do you think?
No, as I'm reading this, they're talking, you know, I'm listening to you, but I'm trying to read at the same time, and they're talking a lot about Mary Magdalene, her bloodline, the, let's see, I guess they're talking about the Last Supper in some place and the Priory of Sion and all this different shit about what, you know, who formed after Christ's crucifixion, which served as Mary Magdalene's bloodline, many of the artists, blah, blah, blah. I don't know, man. It's, I guess it's saying the secret is something like royal blood.
She was in the, one of the characters in that book was in the lineage of royal blood, yeah.
Damn. If you ever watched,
I don't know.
You ever watched, what's the one after Da Vinci Code, Angels and Demons? You ever watch that?
No, I don't think so. Watch that first one, is all. I can't remember. Maybe I did.
Watch Angels and Demons, dog. It looks just like Batman vs. Superman. There's a lot, like, the look of it is like, a lot of scenes look like the office scene with Lex and his, when he had the painting upside down and all that shit like that. A lot of scenes, yeah, if you watch it, you'll see. It gives you the feel of Batman vs. Superman. So it kind of, as soon as I saw it, I was watching it, and I was like, damn, this kind of reminds me of Batman vs. Superman, you know? And then they're talking about it in the movie, and there's like this, they're talking about CERN. They're talking about just all kind of shit. So I remember I posted something about it on Vero, and Zack Snyder liked it, liked the comparison between Batman and Superman and Angels and Demons. It was weird, though. But if you watch it, you might... Maybe we're on to something, and I got to do a little bit more studying. But keep talking. I'm reading. I can hear you.
Let's talk about his post. So I forgot what I got caught up in it because there's so much to say today about what he said, you know? So, like, he said, what is the secret to the Grail?
Right.
And I wrote back, you and the land are one, right?
Right.
And he goes, yes. Oh, and then he sends me a message. Well, not a message. In the post, he says, now drink. I was like, what, dude?
Oh, yeah?
But it's for everyone to drink. Right? It kind of felt kind of special, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Is that what the crack is? That's the crack, right?
That is that crack right there, bro. That's a potent uncut dose of Zach crack.
What's that?
I said, that is an uncut dosage of Zach crack.
No kidding, dude. Here, you know, for a moment, the geek in me, the fan, the nerd, the whatever, the cultist in me was in that moment drinking from that Grail, and he was pouring it. You know what I mean? Like... It was pretty cool. It was sort of like one of those moments, like in the journey that you get, and it kind of felt otherworldly. You know what I mean?
Right. Like, right. So
I guess you wouldn't know what I mean because he didn't do that for you.
Oh, I have the most Zach crack on the planet Earth. Yo.
Well, because, I mean, I think you share it a lot more than anyone else. A lot of other people, your kind of exposure.
I get more Zach crack than everybody.
You cut that Zach crack with that vitamin B, man, and you don't want that. Anyways, like before you go into the right after the call of adventure, you get these supernatural aid, you know,
right.
and you go through the threshold, and there's guardians and there's a mentor, and it kind of felt like all of that, you know,
right.
it's sort of like that,
right?
That's that Zach track. I think he does this for a lot of people.
Yeah, and, no, he does. He does. And they
and
all,
I think
they all contact me. They all show me, hey, man, I got some Zach crack today. And see, I don't even want to show my shit anymore. I don't even show as much. Sometimes
yeah.
I'd be like, Yeah, I got three already today. Leave me alone. But I don't say that.
Oh, shit.
I'd be like, yeah, good job, man. Good job. I like when people, I like when they feel that way, you know?
Yeah, me too. I mean, it feels good to see them on their journey.
Right.
Now, I've gotten likes from him before, but never this, you know. This was something else.
Right.
There's also a couple other things he put on there. And since this is all, so like that stuff, if he likes my post, that's between me and him. But this is like his post and he's sharing this information publicly. I think this was okay, you know. Mm-hmm. So to talk about. So did you notice that someone asked him about the soundtrack? Is it done? Is the, not the soundtrack, you know, the score?
No, I didn't see that.
Yeah, well, he said Tom's got it all covered.
Oh, wow. Wow. Let me ask you this, though. Have you ever heard that Excalibur and the Knights of the Round Table were actually the bloodline of Jesus?
I know, huh? That's something.
Yeah, I heard that before. Have you ever heard that Jesus?
I think King Arthur.
Yeah, yeah, maybe. King Arthur. Hey, is it true? I heard this somewhere before, and I can't even remember. But years ago, somebody said something like, "At a portion of his life," and I'm not a big like a Bible dude or anything like that. Was Jesus ever banished to Europe, or was his bloodline ever like in hiding in Europe anywhere?
I don't know. Damn. That sounds like that. And nothing in the Bible says that, I don't think. I don't know.
Right.
I'm not sure. I think he was always... I don't know. I don't know. There's a gap. So.
Yeah.
I know that his bloodline was being attacked. But then why would... Why would it be after he was already alive? So I don't know.
I don't know. I heard that somewhere that said something either like his bloodline was in hiding in France or somewhere in Europe, and King Arthur and something about King Arthur and the Knights of the Round Table had some connection to Jesus or his bloodline, something like that. I just got to find it. I got to get back on my studying. But another question I want to ask you. You said today is your mother's birthday?
Yeah. Yes.
That's what you started with today on Twitter. That's the first thing I saw.
Yeah. I told you guys in the chat that I wasn't even going to be around. I'd probably tweet a couple times and then dip. But I was stuck all day just trying to promote.
Yeah, how you feeling, though?
Well, it was a rough day, man. Rough day. I don't...
You want
to... It was a hard day not to focus on...
Yeah.
...other things, but it was kind of nice to have the distraction, too.
Right.
From thinking about her, because, you know... Like, that was, you know, it's kind of like she kept me, I was sheltered, you know, and when that shelter was removed, I know what to do, you know, and then I just joined the group, and I was kind of dipping my toes in.
Right.
To the group on Twitter. And when around the time she was passing, because that was around the time Justice League was coming out, and I started seeing, like, this, you know, all the bad stuff, and you know, Chris Cornell passed that year too.
Yeah.
it was a real hard year for me.
Right.
Because if you ask me, you know, who's the only person I listen to on Spotify, it's Chris.
Really?
Whether it's Soundgarden or Audio Slave or him in his solo career.
Right.
And then my mom passes. And if you would have said, can you make it through the world without her? I would have told you no.
Right.
And then I fell. I mean, I fell hard. And then, you know, and I hate to say that a movie does so much for me, but it does. In comparison to my mom, hardly, but it was the final blow, you know, right. Seeing that mess.
Right.
And when you want, you know, it's like seek and you shall find, right?
Right.
So I wanted answers. I wondered, you know, what the hell happened? And I found this group. And I tell you what, I saw the dozen or so people that had to release the Snyder Cut sign up, and they were outside Warner Brothers, and they were protesting. And I was like, oh, no.
Yeah?
You know, a dozen people just showed up, and that's it. Like, so this will never happen.
Right, you thought it wasn't shit back then, huh?
It wasn't going to happen.
Right.
I had no hope, no. I was in the, I mean, it wasn't my doubting people, it was my doubt.
Right.
It was me.
Right.
You know, I'm projecting, you know, I want to see failure because fuck it. Depression is like that, you know?
Right.
And, but there was something that kept drawing me back. I don't know what it was. I have no idea. Probably because there was the only hope. I'm not going to ever get my mom back. Only memories. I'm not getting Chris back. No more music. Just what he's already had, right? So
right.
The only place I could find hope in the things I lost was this group.
Right.
So when I something kept that kept me coming back, you know, coming back, trying to figure it out. Eventually, my one or two visits to Twitter every 2 weeks turned into 1 week, turned into 1 day, turned into all day.
Right.
And I just kept pushing. And I'll tell you, man, I started finding hope in these people, these strangers.
Right.
And they changed my life.
Right.
I went from, and yet, you know, you asked Paul too, Lord Smarmy Pants. I mean, Zach's art saved our lives.
Yeah, that's what he said. He said he almost committed suicide.
Man, those thoughts are there for me.
Damn.
We're there.
Damn.
And, you know, my work was horrible. My boss wanted me to stay at work instead of see my mom.
Right. I remember you
during her life. Yeah. So, I mean, I had nothing except for these people. And then these people grew from, you know, that dozen to whatever it is now, you know,
right.
20,000, you know, a group that, that was able to donate over $110,000 to American Foundation for Suicide Prevention. We got, I wish I was a part of this, but I wasn't. Lena on Vero donated, started a GoFundMe to donate $1,000 to kids that want to just to give them art, the art supplies so they can draw, so they can color, so they can do whatever.
Oh wow, really?
In a community that didn't have those resources. to allow them to expand their mind and in a creative way.
Right.
And she through this movement was able to donate $1,000 to do that. And that is tremendous. Now, which brings us back to why anyone would attack these things. It just blows my mind.
Right. Right.
This movement saves lives. I guarantee you more people than just me and Paul have had those issues, and they just don't want to talk about it.
Right. Right. So what gives you the strength to talk about it?
Man, when you get that low, like, nothing really matters. So I have no fear.
Mm. Damn.
That's... I've seen it. I've come face to face with my ego.
Right.
And my ego wanted to kill me.
So
my ego said, "You pussy, you should just kill yourself."
Yeah, why do you connect that to your ego?
Yes, I mean, who am I? What an arrogant piece of shit to think that I can't go through some shit.
Right.
Like, I'm too good to have my mom die. Whatever. Everyone's mom dies.
Right, right.
Like I'm too good to have things taken away from me. There's kids in other countries that dodge bullets to go to school. I mean, who am I?
Right.
So that's the ego, I think.
So you had to come to grips with that you're nobody special.
Yeah.
Damn.
Yeah, I mean, I am capable of special things. I mean, but I'm not. I'm no better or less than anyone else. I mean, there's a balance there.
Damn, Jeff.
It's cool.
So, when you said you went to that event and it was only like 12 people there.
I didn't go there. No, I just saw it online. Oh, no, right. I didn't go there.
Is that the one where everybody was holding like the sign in Hollywood?
Yeah, it was a banner.
Yeah, I remember that. And it was, yeah, you're right. It was only like 12 people. And they had costumes on, right?
Yeah, they were really...
Yeah. Yeah.
They were really committed, man. That was, you know, I look back and I'm ashamed of my reaction to it, but that's because I just wanted to give up. That's just because I was enabling myself to fail. So in reality, what they did was some of the most beautiful things ever. And they were the first, and they're amazing people.
Right, right, definitely.
Because without them, those are my roots. You know, that's our roots. And right. Without them, who knows where we'd be?
Right.
And who knows where I'd be individually? Who knows where... Well, Paul was protected by BVS, so...
Where are those guys now? Like,
I don't know.
Yeah?
I don't know. That's a good question.
That's weird. Like, you got... All right, we're talking about this Holy Grail, and we're talking about the Knights of the Round Table and, you know, Jesus and his 12 apostles. And it was like 12 people that started this shit off. And where did they go? Did they just disappear back? Like, where are those guys who held up the sign, you know?
Well, I know... If anyone deserves a seat at that table, Fiona does, and I don't think she was there.
Yeah, definitely Fiona. Definitely. Damn, I got off my subject. I was about to continue. So when did you start feeling shit changed?
I don't know. I think we just started getting... I think people were showing love, and And to me, you know, people will show, you know, I'd be honest. I was open and honest with people and let them know where I was coming from. You know, maybe I said some things that I was going through thinking, and, you know, they gave me back some. They gave me back some positive feedback, and so because I felt like they were giving back to me, so I gave back, and that's what I think really cemented my strength, was to give back. It felt good, you know.
Right.
I saw all these other people giving their talent, and I don't have any talent, so I just gave money. Which people responded, they thought it was it was good of me and Hamad, and we went on a little back and forth, and I think we raised like 20 something thousand that year.
Hell yeah.
There's no credit there. I gave, that's not my money anymore. So that was that.
Yeah, but
I don't know how to say it. Maybe you got to dig around.
Nah, you went down a history with that shit, dog. That's how I started, because I used to see you on Twitter, on Vero a lot. And then I remember I was in a room, the SCDC Comic-Con or whatever, and you were in there.
Mm-hmm.
And everybody was praising you for giving this money. And I never talked, but I used to read it and shit. So then I just finally started talking to you one day. I think we were talking about your little Honda or some kind of car you had. Yeah, and then it was...
My PRX.
Yeah, yeah, and then it was cool.
Love that car.
Because everybody was talking to you about money, so I'm thinking you got like a BMW or some shit like that, and then you start talking about a Honda. So I'm like, all right, this dude is cool, man. So I think that's how we started talking. You know?
Yeah, I don't have a ton of money, but it's whatever. It went to a good... At least half of it, I can say, if nothing else, half of it went to a really good cause. One that, you know, I can hold close to my heart. I never had to give him a call, but I got close. I mean, I should have gave him a call, maybe.
Right.
You know, but I had the support of this group, so they were my way out from the dark path.
Right.
I don't want to say too much, because one of these days they might just get me and say, look, he had tendencies.
No, I mean, you're not.
You know what I mean? Those, I just, like that Epstein stuff.
No. No. You say a lot of dumb shit, but I think everybody know you're just playing around.
The dumb shit, yeah.
I don't know what tendencies you're talking about, but hopefully I haven't witnessed any of them.
Oh my God, no. The same stuff we've been talking about.
Oh, okay.
Right. Dang, dude.
I don't want to be indicted in
prevention, sir.
Yeah, no, hell no. I just don't want to be indicted in your federal case if anything pops up later on.
You are a pain in the ass sometimes.
Yo, so I'm reading this shit that said the Knight Templars got close with this group named the Qatari.
And you're gonna edit that, please? Always say you will, but fuck it, right?
I got it.
All right, the Knights Templar. Let's change the subject.
All right. The Knights Templar. They got close to this group, and this group believed in a perfect man, a sort of an illuminated savior, whom they called the Widow's Son,
and the term applied to Percival in all Grail romances. The illuminated savior or perfect man can probably be connected to Superman, huh?
Ooh, yes.
So you think that's what Zach was talking about with the... Because, you know, Percival got kind of distracted by a lady, right?
Oh, you're talking about... Okay.
With that picture. You. That picture.
And yeah, no, I think Percival was us, but...
Oh, yeah? Explain it.
It might have a double meaning.
Because maybe...
I think we're tempted by... When... You know, what happened? What are you when you're drunk?
You're...
Intoxicated.
Intoxicated, right.
Toxic.
Okay.
And she was getting him drunk to make him lose his way. And then she was going to take the Grail.
Ah, yeah. But... What if he's this perfect illuminated savior and Danny Garcia was distracting him?
I knew you were going to get there. But I said, I think we don't know. I think we have no idea what's going on behind the scenes. And I think Henry has either he has a good, he's playing a good hand, a good poker face. I mean, there's plenty of options. It could be like, it could be that he is being loyal to what projects he's on now. It could be that he's playing the game to get more money. Who knows? I don't know. I think he's more, if he is, so... If he is being influenced by her, I don't think she's into it for what art is told.
Hmm.
So I think that
she's in for the money. Right, for the money.
And I think they should just pay him whatever he wants.
Yeah, really?
Yeah, I don't think he's in this movie very long, though.
Hmm, okay.
I think he'll be resurrected, and he'll be in, like, some kind of, like, in the comics, you know? He's in some kind of, like, stasis.
Right.
Regeneration stasis.
Right.
And then he comes back at the end.
Right. Okay.
Black suit, long hair, beard. Let's go.
Right.
You know, he got on the, he went to set to film Mission Impossible with the beard, and McQuarrie had no idea, the director, right. No idea. And he goes, okay. So that tells me.
He had a beard in the movie. That's what you're saying.
Yeah. Did you watch Night Hunter?
Night Hunter? No, I never watched it.
That's his other movie he did between Justice League and Mission Impossible. I think it came out after Mission Impossible, though.
Yeah, it's like a scary movie or something like that?
Yeah, like he was a detective or something, and he went and...
Yeah,
I think he was hunting a serial killer or something. Yeah, I don't know.
I remember the commercial. I remember the trailer.
Yeah. And he had... So he had long. Everyone's sharing this now.
Everyone sharing
Excalibur stuff. I love it. Man, people need to watch that movie.
Yo, I'm reading this shit now, dog. And listen, man, it's so much shit that.
It's too much.
Yeah, dog, it's too much. You think Zach was trying to tell, like, a different version of the Bible and use, like, comic book characters? And somebody didn't like that shit?
Oh, I see where you're going. Maybe. I mean, BVS had it. A lot of themes, so did Man of Steel. Right. He went to a church to find guidance.
Right.
I mean, he went to God. He went to Jesus to find guidance.
Right.
But so.
You're right. So, you're right.
And then BVS, one of the first lines is, Holy God, creator of heaven and earth, please have mercy on the soul.
Right.
So. And then two planes hit the towers.
Right. But you're right. I'm reading all of this shit, like the Grail family, the conclusion, the bibliography, all of this shit while we're talking, and I see the fucking House of David, and then, you know, what's his name? Darkseid, even that picture of him in the cave or whatever, like the drawing, the original drawing that Wonder Woman found.
Oh, yeah.
It looked like he had a Star of David on his chest. You know, it kind of looked like the Merkaba, which is like a Star of David is just like the two-dimensional picture of that. And it looks like that's what Darkseid had on his chest. And the more I read about this Grail family, that could be like Darkseid's the family. Or, you know, all this shit. And it looks like Zack Snyder was trying to tell like a deeper version, maybe like the Dan Brown Angels and Demons version of the Bible with comic book characters.
Maybe. I hear he has a he remembers everything. One of those photogenic memories.
Photographic memories, bro.
Is that it? Okay.
I think. I don't know.
And we know what we mean. And, it's okay. It doesn't matter if your viewers do. So. What is this? Sorry. Saw something.
No, it's all right. What'd you see? Because I know where you're reading from. What's going on?
No, it's the other chat.
Oh.
Did this, dude. Okay, whatever. Someone made a post about you and the Lander One, and he liked it. Of course he's going to like it. It's his content. It doesn't matter who it's from. Get real. Stop playing games. People are... It's in our chat. People are trying to mince words with start infighting again. Just block these people. Sorry, that's a tangent. I didn't even have any context. How appropriate. No context.
It's all good. So go back to photographic memory.
So he has a photographic memory. And so apparently his... he can recall very specific things from any comic book ever. So, like he's ever read, he has one of those memories, you know, and that's what makes him so good at adaptation, you know? So I would be under the assumption that he's not only does he like Excalibur, we knew that, I would be under the assumption that he would have thorough knowledge of King Arthur and Knights of the Round Table and trying to converge those things.
Right.
With Justice League.
Right.
As for the other things, I'm sure all this lore, this mythology, no matter if it's or Greek gods or Roman gods or whatever, I'm sure he has ample understanding of all that, given that one of his mentors, I think he's his mentor, is Joseph Campbell.
Right.
So I think, you know, you put all these ideas up in your head and it kind of blends around until it makes some kind of sense, and then you've got a puzzle piece you can try to put in the big picture.
Right, right.
So as for adapting some biblical thing, maybe. He already has, so.
Yeah, I mean like some secret biblical thing. Do you believe in like like all that secret society shit? You believe in that shit?
I don't know why I'd be stopped. Well, yeah, sure.
Right? So it's like, there's like a whole different, like say for instance, there's a knowledge that the masses have, you know, like Jesus, X, Y, and Z. And then the secret societies have a whole different type of knowledge, right? They believe something totally different that maybe is a deeper knowledge and a deeper understanding than what we, the masses, even understood. So maybe Zack Snyder knows that deeper meaning to shit. And he was putting it out in his movie. And the people who also know, but they don't want the masses to know, they saw it. And they're like, hold on a second, Zack. You can't do shit like that. You know? And they tried to stop him. Remember when the dude made... When Mel Gibson made that movie, and then after that shit, everybody fucking hated him. All of a sudden,
Passion of the Christ movie,
right? Passion of the Christ, right? Or like,
right.
What?
Me?
Yeah. What are you? I didn't say nothing, bro. Oh,
sorry.
All right. But, you know, like when people start going on this Jesus route or anything like that, like shit gets bad for them in Hollywood or entertainment or anything like that. You ever notice that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, even on set, Jim Caviezel was struck by lightning.
Who?
The guy who played Jesus in that movie.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah. He got struck by lightning in that. During filming. I think that's true.
Have you ever heard of the Superman curse?
Yes.
Do you believe that shit?
I think there's a history. I think America is such a young country that grew up really fast and didn't take time to understand psychology or appreciate it. So much so that people were susceptible to their weaknesses without even knowing it. Right. I thinking you're invincible because you played a character that's invincible, you know?
Right.
And that's how some of those guys died, so.
So you don't believe in, like, the supernatural or anything like that?
Not in that case. Maybe. I mean, you're making a good point. You got a connection there, at least. So, yeah, I don't know, man. That's pretty wild.
I don't know, man. It's just some... It's like you got this character who could be the illuminated savior of the world, you know? And then you just see how that is some Knights Templar shit, some Holy Grail shit, some Jesus Christ bloodline shit. And now I'm reading this thing in the same article that's saying Jesus and Mary had a baby. You ever heard about that?
Yeah, and the baby is royal bloodline.
Right.
Yeah.
Like the Illuminati shit.
So, I don't see why... I mean, so, like, they got secretly married.
Right.
You know what? Anything's possible, right? So, okay. I'm not gonna fight it. Because if you start... doing that, if you start throwing all your eggs into one basket, then whoever owns that basket is going to do whatever they want with your eggs.
Yeah, like what? Like what do you like mean?
If I buy into everything someone says, then I'm gonna be let down, I think.
Right.
Someone might take all my eggs and sell them.
So you're saying pretty much anything is possible.
Anything is possible. So, and how does that compromise anything? I don't think it does. I don't think it compromises anything. I think you got the Bible, which is put together by people that wanted to start a religion to control people. I've never been in a church. They don't ask for money.
Right.
Jesus said that he'll take care of all the, you know, all the birds and all every creature. So don't worry about that sort of thing. It'll be taken care of.
Right.
I go to churches that, you know, they'll give you a statement of their earnings and it'll be like $1,000 a month.
Right.
But they're getting huge donations from private people.
Right.
And then those private people are trying to have influence on what the church preaches. So.
Right.
Because I've seen it. Oh, my uncle was a preacher. I've seen all that stuff. The church is inside you if you believe in God.
Right.
You are the church. So.
Okay, but you know, I kind of agree with that. Like, but
so I wouldn't stumble too. I would. I'm easily to stray off the path of the Word of God. I mean, what is considered the Word of God? As long as it doesn't compromise the story, that God came down and died for our sins. So. And it doesn't. Who says he couldn't get married and have a baby?
Right. That's what I'm saying. Like, there could be this literal depiction of the Bible, and then there could be, hey, guys, it could be a more deeper version that only a certain few people know. Right? And then, like, in this new age of Aquarius or this new, you know, fucking age of awakening or whatever, some people like Zack Snyder, you know, maybe Dan Brown, even, you know, like the movie Prometheus or anything, some people are trying to wake you up with a deeper version of the Bible, right? So then but then those people that, like, you ever seen the movie Book of Eli?
Yeah.
And you remember Gary Oldman? He wanted the Bible to control the whole town. Mm-hmm. And Denzel Washington was like, no, you can't. You know, this Bible means much more than that. So,
yeah.
So there is that literal version that's of the Bible that's meant for controlling people. But there is a more deeper version that's meant to liberate people. But the people are so dumb, they need somebody to teach them that liberating message.
Yeah.
And the people who are in control, they want us to stay dumb so they could not have the liberated message and just have the controlling message, right? So let's say Hollywood is Gary Oldman and Zack Snyder is Denzel Washington. You see what I'm saying now?
Yeah.
Do you think we're sitting in a situation like that?
I know what he is trying to convey is extremely liberating. And I know that something doesn't want it to be given to the people. Now, I also believe that we weren't ready for it.
Right. I agree.
I think more people are ready for it now because of this last 2 years.
I 100% agree.
And I feel ashamed of myself to not be ready for it, but I was not ready for it when others were. We have many people in the... And they're just so beautiful with their patience and kindness, like Truth, Love, Faith.
Right.
She knows. You can tell. She was ready for this movie more than 2 years ago. And right. She's so kind and patient with me, knowing that she has to know that she waited to see this movie because of people like me. And...
You know what?
Anything but sweet and supportive.
I love Truth, Love, Faith. I love Truth, Love, Faith. She's pretty. She's happy all the time. But, you know, I don't think you're that... I think you're taking some credit away from you. I think you're ready for it. You might have had different shit going on in life, but I think you could watch it and completely understand what he was trying to say.
Well, maybe 7 years ago, I would have been ready for it. And then I went to school, to college, and my ego got fed, and it took away who I really was.
Right.
I was 3.8 GPA, all that means is I was able to regurgitate information. Didn't mean I was very intelligent. Right. It meant I could retain information and spew it back out like one of these, you know, these, like a bot.
Right.
And what it did was it made me feel overconfident, just my ego was taking over. And it's a good thing because it lay dormant until given the opportunity to take control, or else I would have never known it exists. And when it did take control, it wanted to send me down a dark path because that's its only goal.
Mm.
Maybe... to see things like that. I mean, and then you see these other... So you see the 40 Club. They are very egocentric. They believe they need credit for everything, every discovery made, no matter who discovers it. They called it, you know.
Right.
And what does it do, though? You see this ego creating separation between people. You see that you think you should be above them, and when you're not, you're offended
right.
at those people.
Right.
They're not bowing to you. Three kinds of people in this world.
I think that's the perfect way to say about the 40 Club. I think that's perfect because they were our first YouTubers in this movement, you know? And then it's like when they didn't get the credit for us blowing up, they got pissed at all of us, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I hope that's all it is. I mean, there could be something beyond that, that they're getting manipulated by someone with power.
Right.
But I hope not.
So let's go back to this liberated message. What do you think Zach could be trying to say?
To have confidence in yourself, that you can be a hero. I mean, look at what Man of Steel did. Him at his bravest wasn't flying in the air, wasn't beating up Zod. Okay, maybe killing him was pretty brave, but because, you know, the backlash on that.
Right.
But Like, he was restrained when he could have destroyed. He could have conquered the entire world.
Right.
But he held back. And that takes bravery. I don't care what you say. I mean, you know, everything he did that was the epitome of man can be done by man.
Right.
If you look at him like he's a god, then you miss the point.
Mm.
I think the point was, you have this power.
And that's
you have a power for change, you know, like powerful art.
And that's what he's trying to say.
Yeah, that a whole message. Yeah, powerful art can, what is it? Can create change.
Right. So, but then we got, you know what I mean? Like the Holy Grail type shit. I agree with the powerful art, but I guess what I'm trying to look for, what's this magic, this like biblical type meaning to it?
Well, I think one more thing. I'm sorry. Wonder Woman. She's powerful.
Right.
She's someone my daughters can look up to. That right. All the women in the movement, and most of the men can look up to. I don't know. We take everyone. Right. Could be some sexist guys out there that love Zach, but whatever. They'll come around. You know, eventually ignorance will be wiped away with truth. You know, as long as we're feeding them truth, eventually they'll come around. So I think Wonder Woman, look at what they're trying to turn her into.
Right.
Look at the whisperings and the shit that we're getting from 84 coming out. That it's not going to be, she's going to find a different way to destroy evil. I think that's something to be said there, you know. I hope one day that we find out that she killed her father at the end of Wonder Woman.
Why?
What, her father wasn't Zeus.
You said,
that'd be kind of cool.
You said her father wasn't Zeus? What?
Yeah. Yeah, what if her father was Ares? She killed her father at the end.
Oh, now you're going a little too deep, bro.
Yeah, man, whatever, you know, it's a pretty cool idea. But it would add depth, certainly better than
right.
Certainly better than, you know, whatever else they had planned for, whatever they have planned for her. I don't know. I have no idea. It kind of worries me. But whatever, you know, it can exist. People will like it. I think as long as we get Zach's 5-story arc, anything else can happen. You can have, you know, the Flash and Aquaman go on an adventure. You know, whatever. Whatever, have it. But just as long as we get this self-contained 5-story arc and we have all these, the multiverse happening all around it. It's cool. Whatever. As far as the Holy Grail, so it says, you and the land are one. And he drank, King Arthur drank from this. He had drank from the Grail that Percival brought back. Mm-hmm. You good?
Yeah. I just dropped some scissors. I'm bullshitting around. Go ahead.
Trimming the ends off that blunt. So, Percival brought the Grail back to King Arthur. King Arthur drank from it, and the land was renewed, and so was he. King Arthur was on his deathbed. And so when he drank from this, I think in this case, it's Darkseid terraforming the Earth. I mean, That happened in the history lesson. What, did it just grow back over? I don't think so. I'm very curious on, though, who King Arthur is in the Justice League.
King Arthur is probably related to Batman some way. They're both knights. Knights.
Hunters. Oh, knights.
Dark Knight.
So that would mean that... So, do you remember the end of Justice League and everything turns? The land is renewed.
Right. Of Justice League. Justice League, right?
It's Justice League, but I've heard Zach shot that. We've seen black and whites of them standing up there.
Happy, right, right.
Together, someone saying something. But if he drinks, does Batman drink from the Grail? I don't know the spiritual side of all this.
See, I think the cup is just... I think the cup is literal. I think the cup is like Gary Oldman. I think the real version of the Grail is what Zack Snyder's talking about.
Holy shit.
I think he's talking about bloodline and babies and new saviors. I don't think he's talking about a cup at all. So if we get the knights, remember the original knights, the men, they buried their mother box. And
the kings of men.
Right. And you can kind of tie that into like the Knight Templars and all this shit, and all the way up to Batman, the Dark Knight. And then
it would make sense because they were, I mean, these rich.
Right.
That is not just from his dad. That's right. From his dad's dad, his dad's dad, 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 dad.
Right. Right.
Just keep on going. Right. Yeah. I dig it. I'm following you. I'm on it.
Right. So I think renewing is either Batman's son or baby. And I think it was him and Wonder Woman that got together.
Oh my God, it's Lois.
Yeah, could be Lois, but I think Lois kicked the bucket.
No. Okay, so in one timeline she dies, in the other timeline she's saved. Before that happens, they could have took care of the old business.
Right?
If that's true, okay, so if you look at King Arthur, if you look at Excalibur, King Arthur's right-hand man was, what's his name? Shit. The guy in the shiny armor.
Shit, I don't know.
Yeah, you do. Everyone knows.
Yeah, I remember.
Thanks.
I'll
pull it up if you don't.
No, I'll pull it up. I remember. Because he had his own movie also, not too long ago.
Lancelot.
Right, Lancelot. Right.
So Lancelot is his right-hand man. King Arthur. And then Lancelot hooked up with Guinevere. And King Arthur saw them.
Right.
Holy fuck, dude.
So Batman had a...
Which brings us back to the t-shirt.
Right. Did Batman have an affair with Amy Adams?
Lois Lane, Guinevere. Oh my God. Dude, people are going to laugh at this. Here's the problem. If that is the truth... Now, I've put that out there before. And if this is the truth, people are going to have a problem with that. They aren't ready.
No, they're not ready.
Because I get laughed at all the time for it.
Will that be like the nightmare scene when he was like, she was my girl and I cared about
her? She was my world and you took her from me.
Right.
That's it, dude. That's what the motivation is there. I mean, you'd kick my ass if I banged your old lady.
So.
Whether you were dead or not. You're coming back from the grave to get my ass, dude.
So
for real, though.
So Flash says the key is Lois. Don't screw Lois.
Yeah, you were right about him, man. He's a cockblock.
He'll carry you over that pussy.
You got Merlin, too. Now, Merlin could be on the other side. From what I remember, that Superman is not making that dirt rise from his grave.
Right.
It's a boom tube or something. Now, that could be Desaad.
Right.
Could be Merlin.
Right.
And in this case. And then Merlin would bring him back.
I'm still thinking the baby is Wonder Woman's and Batman's baby.
It could have been. It could be. It could have been changed. Now, if you do look at, or it could have been this way the whole time. If you look at the Injustice storyline, that is Superman's woman.
Right.
Is Wonder Woman. So.
Right. Correct. Correct, correct, correct.
And then they got to go get Supergirl to go fight Superman. Supergirl's in 10,000 years in the past. I guess you're going to have a treadmill.
But what about that open pod on the ship? Was that not Supergirl? Because remember Zack Snyder said it's somebody bigger. It's something bigger than Supergirl.
Something bigger, yeah. Yeah, that's... That's got to be the original Doomsday, because he said Doomsday wasn't BVS. See, he's so secret. He's so secretive. Everything's so close to the chest with him that when people find out, they think he's just making it up on the fly. I've seen so many message boards or whatever.
Right.
And I, you know, I've been kicked off of websites because I disagreed with people, you know?
Right.
That, like, all this was planned. Right. If you look at it all.
Right.
It was all planned.
Right.
But I guess we're just going to have to wait until history tells the story.
So
the only way that's going to happen is if all three films are released.
Right. In Excalibur, remember the scene where the one guy stabbed another guy and it was kind of like Superman and...
And Doomsday? Yeah.
Who was that? Was that Lancelot stabbing him and then he got stabbed? Who was that?
That was King Arthur and his son, I think.
So King Arthur stabbed his son and somebody stabbed him?
They stabbed each other.
Right.
Now, King Arthur's son stabbed him and then he pulled the sword through him. So he could stab his son.
Right.
And now there, I think that's what did you call it? A curse. A family curse that he was trying to end. So we would have, Bruce Wayne or Bruce Kent and Superman? I don't think that's going to go.
No. No. All right. So tie it back to Superman. Because Superman stabbed Doomsday.
Superman stabbed Doomsday, and Doomsday stabbed Superman, and Superman pulled his whatever that thing was on the end of his arm, his bone. Man, fuck your bone spurs. that thing on the end of his arm, and he pulled it through him so he could get the sword of destiny, the spear of destiny deeper. Hey, spear destiny.
Right.
Too much.
It is a lot. It's a lot, dog. It's a lot.
Dude, he's genius.
He is. That's what I'm trying to figure this shit out. Because it's he's like...
fucking genius. You know it's his vision. And you know he's like... You know, give Chris Terrio all the props in the world. But that's Zach saying, hey, here's my idea. What he's probably picking his brain on it to get it fleshed out. But I think it's all his it's his idea, you know. It's his vision. But Terrio was a Excalibur fan too, so they're in good company together. I'm sure they've collaborated together on it.
So what's the connections with Excalibur and Zorro? You ever seen Zorro? Because both of those movies were playing in BVS.
Zorro, the Mask of Zorro was, I think it was to give Bruce an idea of how to hide his identity or something.
Mm.
I don't know. I'm sure it goes deeper than that, though.
Right.
I'm not too sure.
What, you ever seen the Count of Monte Cristo? You ever seen the Count of Monte Cristo?
Not in forever.
Yeah. Isn't...
I don't remember it.
Yeah. All right. Never mind.
Sorry, dude. Yeah, I know. Here, I can catch up, though.
No, I'm just trying to figure it out. There's so many, like, Jesus, King Arthur connections and shit. I gotta get on my studying, bro.
Oh, sure, yeah. I think everyone should go out and watch Excalibur immediately if they haven't already. Even if they have recently. Go watch it. Go watch Dune. Dune's terrific. Those both came out in the early 80s. A lot of really good films came out in the 80s that maybe this generation that, you know, this generation hasn't had the opportunity to go discover yet.
Right. What were they trying to tell us back then?
Who? What were those stories trying to tell us?
Yeah.
Well, I think Dune was about, you know, one man against an empire. So that's pretty cool. Well, he wasn't just any man. He was, you know, prophecy and all that.
Right.
Had special powers. Pretty cool.
Mm.
Excalibur. Oh man. The funny thing about that is, like, so Merlin is not like he doesn't. Like you would think he was to King Arthur. Like, he's like, well, these guys, he kind of guides them, you know, but he's still, he knows when King Arthur is like over his head.
Right.
He's like, I'm not with this, you right. know, bring it back a notch.
Right.
You know, sort of thing.
Right.
You also have the Lady of the Lake, which provides Excalibur to the Chosen One, and I'm really interested in if Excalibur shows up, but I'm pretty sure if you will. Watch the Justice League trailer. You just see the box landing, the mother box landing grave. That hole they dug for it, right?
You see the box, the, say that again?
They just tossed the box into the into the hole, the kings of men.
Right, correct.
And then you don't see anything else. You just see them standing over it.
Right.
So they may have thrown the Grail in there too. What's interesting is that we have we have Cyborg going through history, World War II, Nazi camp. Mm-hmm. And if you watch Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade, the Nazis were after the Holy Grail.
Right, correct.
Was it? Yeah, Last Crusade, yeah.
Yeah.
Nazis were after the Holy Grail, so what if they got it, you know? And that's what they were looking for. They weren't looking for the mother box, because they already knew where all three mother boxes were, don't they? Yeah. Yeah, one was in the ocean, one was in Themyscira, and one was Silas Stone's.
Right.
So why were they going through that Nazi camp?
Maybe because they had that technology back in the day.
What technology?
The mother box.
To see how it worked?
No, maybe they stumbled upon it. You know, like, you know.
Sure, they had it. Maybe they had it, but what were they? Why would they need to confirm who had it or not?
Why would who need to confirm who had it?
Why would the Justice League need to know that who had the?
No, that I think maybe Cyborg was looking at when it was most recently operational, other than when Silas Stone had it. You know, like, let's say Silas got it from Project Paperclip, maybe, you know, and the government been holding on to it for then. But maybe the Nazis were playing with it right before the war ended, you know?
And what kind of information would you receive from that?
Shit.
From knowing if they had it or not. I think they were looking for the Holy Grail.
The Nazis?
No. I think they had it. I think Cyborg was looking for it.
Right. I
don't know why though.
I still think Cyborg, I still think the Holy Grail is blood more than the actual chalice.
But you're saying that,
like,
Bruce Wayne is blood, so the blood's already there.
Right. Like, look at the shirt, right? There's like sperm and what it looks like tears, but that could be blood.
I think it's blood, yeah.
Right. And then
And
look at the sword is going right through Wayne.
Oh my God.
Wayne's coffin. That sword could be Excalibur. The round table is right there. The knight's sitting, the six different swords on the round table, you know?
Yeah.
I think the Holy Grail is Bruce Wayne's bloodline. Because I think, like, if it's all the gods are in you, like, let's say Jor-El and his wife was like God or whatever, and Superman was like Jesus, and he came down and he did his Jesus thing, but he had a perfect mirror image of Batman, you know? So when Superman and BVS, he committed suicide too. Batman's not the only person that had a suicide mission, you know? So when Superman was flying to Doomsday, and he was, you know, kissing Lois Lane and telling her I love you and all this shit right before he went and stabbed it. I think Batman has a scene where he does the same thing. Like, there's a lot of mirror and, like, symmetry in these movies. And you can kind of
see what's coming next by seeing what you already saw, you know, if you just kind of mirror it. So I'm thinking all the gods are in you is gonna be like a I think it's gonna be like a quick fast forward, like Batman is gonna see his life flash before his eyes one day, and he kind of is the guy that triggers all of these superheroes, you know?
Wow, man.
That's just what I think. I don't know. But I think the Holy Grail is blood. And I think instead of these teardrops and sperm, I think these teardrops are blood.
Oh, God. So that all the gods are in you is
Batman's baby with Wonder Woman.
Means that all the gods are in him.
Right.
Because of his bloodline.
Right. And he's not, because everybody look at Batman like he's just a regular dude, but he's really not a regular dude. He is the Justice League, you know? It might be a super quiz. You know, like, all right, look
at that. That's why he thinks he can do it himself.
Yeah, he does. Yeah. He does, but then they say you can't save the world by yourself. All right, look at Superman on the shirt. He's the first little dot. And his complete mirror is Batman, right? And so everything that happens to Superman is probably going to happen to Batman. But it was a little foreshadow also, because Wonder Woman already had her boyfriend commit suicide, which flipped her the fuck out. So imagine them getting beat up by Darkseid, just like them getting beat up by Ares, and Batman commits suicide. It will flip Wonder Woman the fuck out, so she will go beat up Darkseid, just like already happened with Ares, you know?
Yeah, I would love to see that.
That's what I'm thinking, but I don't know. So I think the Holy Grail isn't a physical Holy Grail. I think it's more of Batman's bloodline. And I think the Kings of Men has more say in this than anybody. More say than Darkseid, more say than anybody. I think the Kings of Men have been holding on to something serious, and it's Bruce Wayne, you know? Just my opinion.
That's pretty good, dude. That's some deep. That's some deep stuff. You got me geeking.
I don't know. It's just what I've been thinking, because it all mirrors, you know? If you kind of just look at the mirror and then I don't know, man. That's just what I'm thinking. But I think it will all mirror, because, you know, if they were trying to do this thing with Jesus, with Superman, then Jesus kind of died for our sins. The one who's sinning is humans, human nature. The only human involved is Batman. So Superman kind of died for Batman's sins. And to totally flip that, like flip the shirt completely upside down and redeem, now humans have to pay the sacrifice. Who's the only human? Batman. And that sacrifice is reborn with, like, Horus, who avenges his father, and Horus has to be Batman's baby.
What?
Just my opinion.
Wait, I thought Horus was Batman.
Yeah, he is, but he's always... See, Batman is avenging his father. I mean, Superman is... Horus is avenging his father. So, I guess Batman can be Horus.
Is that right, though? Wait.
Osiris is Horus's father, right? So Osiris and Isis had a beef. And Isis kind of got with Set, and they killed Osiris. So now Isis was pregnant when Osiris died. Osiris is now the god of the underworld. He came back through his son Horus, who avenges his father and kills Set, which basically means the horizon over the sun set every day, the sun rising again. So the one who would be the sun rising, that could be Superman or that could be Batman's son.
I was confused. I looked it up. It was Pluto, I think.
Pluto.
Yeah, but this is different. This is an Egyptian. This is Greek.
Oh, okay. Okay. I don't know. It's probably the same.
Yeah. I think Chris Terrio said that he was researching Pluto for Batman.
Right. So who's
Pluto? And then
who's Pluto in Egypt? Who's the connection?
What?
I said, who's Pluto?
Oh, the god of the underworld?
Yeah, that's Osiris.
Okay. I'll confirm. Anubis.
Anubis,
sorry.
Yep. That's the.
Of course you go for the Egyptian side of the...
I'm black.
You got that joke real fast. I love you, man. Because you know me. You know how racist I am.
I know where you were going with that.
Yeah. Batman is Pluto, god of the underworld, and Superman is Apollo, god of the sky.
Mm.
And he thought that was an interesting conflict. Let's see here. Pluto, in secondary myth, in secondary roles in other myths, Pluto is mostly used as an owner of a quest object. The Grail.
The Grail. The mother box.
You dig? You hear me?
Yeah, hello? I hear you. I'm listening.
Yeah, so Pluto is used to in a quest for the hero to go to Pluto to get a quest object of some sort.
Right.
And Anubis. The Wane of the Heart. Oh my god, that sounds so cool.
Damn.
He would weigh their hearts to see if they go where they go, I guess.
Yeah.
Oh my god. That's so wonderful. So poetic, man. I love it.
Yeah.
Wane of the Heart.
All of this so shit deep. Is deep, man. All of it is deep.
Deep.
Well, I don't know. I guess we're gonna have to fucking have a part two to this conversation, because me and you, we're pushing 2 hours that we've been talking.
Holy fuck. Yeah, trim that up, man.
Hell no. I'm going to put this... Hey, do you see how... You ever see how many people are selling Zack Snyder's shirt online?
No.
Yeah. There's like... I'm looking at like 14 different sponsored sites right now.
Yeah.
That's a little crazy. That's,
are they, is that legal, you think? You think they got licensing?
No.
So these are just, you know what, if they're going to do that, they need to pull out the Suicide Squad shirt.
The Suicide Squad shirt?
Yeah, the one the guy's selling on the street corner. Yeah. That says never forget or something like that.
Right.
Oh my gosh, I want that shirt so bad.
Oh man. So we definitely gotta do a part two. Give somebody some shout outs, bro. But we are pushing like 2 hours and that's gonna take like 30 days just to fucking upload.
All right, well, TPZ, I'd like to give them a shout out for motivating us to have fun today.
Yep.
At the detriment of my work, I'd like to also, the Film Exiles, I love those guys. I mean, we were talking in the chat today, like, you know, we're all... You know, just because we got different names, we're all together. We're all one. You know, e pluribus unum, man.
Right.
So it's no sweat. Like, I don't want to single out anyone, right. But because we're all, you know, we're all Percival. We're all seeking the Grail to right. save the king.
Right.
Wow.
Yeah. How did we end up in this shit, dog? This is like a real life actual journey, and it's like a real life, everything we talk about, we can put ourselves into it, you know?
I think we seek deeper meaning for life, not just this facade or this matrix. There's something yeah. better. There has to be. You know?
I think
this just can't be it.
Right. You feel like we're on the outside of the matrix, or are we controlling this shit? Like, did you ever think you'll be a part of a crew that will be the number one worldwide trending topic on the planet?
No. Why? Well, I'd like to say that I have aspirations for something great.
Right. No,
for people.
Right. That's what I'm saying. It's like we're controlling this shit. Like, think about this whole matrix. I know you have aspirations, but they're coming true. You know, like a lot of people have aspirations that shit never come true. You know what I mean? But how are we building this? And how did that shirt that he put out today on the back, how did it fit into us? You know, how did this shit happen like that? You know,
it's a paradox, if you ask me. I mean, you can't have one without the other, but you couldn't have had, but you had one without the other.
It's some weird, it's some weird shit, bro. Like, are we dreaming or are we actually on King Arthur's knight to find the Holy Grail? Are we actually doing that in 2020? What the hell is going on?
No shit, dude. That's a good point. That was... When was that? 1200s?
Shit, I don't know. You're white. That's y'all's story.
Oh, shoot. No, even earlier than that. 500s.
Damn.
Yeah.
Damn.
He's telling a story that there must be some kind of revolution, like not a revolution, but I think it's called cyclical.
Mm-hmm.
Where and then it just happens to be the hero's journey is also you end up where you started, but everything else around you is the same, but you were different.
Right.
And then outward, inward, all that.
Right.
Oh my gosh. Is this our time to ascend? As not as individuals, but as a as humans.
Right. Now we talking.
As they did probably in the 500s.
Right.
What has been squelched to what kind of evil roams the earth to quiet this, to control it? Because they see that power in us.
Right.
They see what we're capable of.
Now we talk.
And they say, how can I control that power?
Right, right. Now we talking. So this cycle has happened before. And some society on this planet knows that. And they're ahead of time. They're like, you know what I mean? Like, Zach knows the cycle. And we just didn't know the cycle. We didn't know that we're living in this cycle. We didn't know that we're fucking these Spartans and shit. We're actually going to go down in history in some way that we fought big corporations, you know? We fought our dark side. But how did this shit happen? Like, we were just some dudes just chilling on the internet or something, you know?
We used all their tools against them.
This is crazy, man.
The Twitter, we used a tool that's normally to bitch out celebrities to come together and, as Brian Kuhn would say, bend time.
Right.
Bend reality.
Right. Right.
I love that guy.
Yeah, Brian is the man.
Yeah, he's just my speed, man.
Yeah, no, I see you two hit it off well, man. Like, you fucking known each other forever.
Yeah, I like the power of discernment, man. Once you have that, you can see through. It's easier to see through the bullshit.
Well, you know, I kind of hooked you guys up, you know?
So you like,
I need 10% of that relationship.
Hitch? Yeah, Hitch? Remember Hitch?
Yeah, I hope it's not like that.
You're on Will Smith.
I see y'all talking and shit, and sometimes I get jealous. I'm like, damn, Brian, we used to talk like that. The fuck are you talking to Jeff, you know?
Whatever, you're in a dozen other chats, I'm sure.
I'm trying to get out of that shit, man. I don't really like, I lose a lot of time at work, and I lose a lot of time in my day trying to keep up with that shit, you know? Okay, and in other news, we have...
What?
Oh, nothing.
No, dude, it's easy to get sucked into other chats. Like, I don't know how many I have. But usually they're just individuals, you know? Like, right. I've got... Well, I was in this one...
You don't have to tell me, dog. They're private messages, bro. That's between you and them.
Nothing panned out, but I hope it will one day.
Oh,
but think about that. Percival went and got the freaking Holy Grail for King Arthur. And I'm going to say, if we're Percival, in reality, we're Percival... I think Zach's King Arthur. I'm just saying.
You think Zach's King Arthur?
If he's King Arthur, then we went and restored everything for him.
Do you think that's what we did?
I'd like to think so. I'd like to think that happened for someone in the world.
Well,
that someone was loved so hard that they believed
Nope.
I mean, wouldn't that be nice to be loved that much?
Yeah, yeah, it would be, but I don't know if I can handle it as good as Zach did. I would think.
No, probably not. But he had a good, I mean, that's why he was, I mean, he was worthy.
Right, exactly.
He was worthy of it. So, like, he had a very good understanding of, and a belief in this Joseph Campbell stuff, man. So, it's so freaking deep.
Yeah, it is. That's why I got this show.
One day I want to talk to him just for, like, a six-pack worth, just to hang out and talk, just to have a few beers and just say, where is your head, man? Yeah. Like, where is it? I'm ready to find out. I can follow it. Just, like, when I was five or six, I put together my first 500-piece puzzle.
Damn.
I mean, I can put things together. But sometimes I need to look at the front of the box.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right.
I need to see the whole picture before I can put it together.
Right.
I think with him, I think he's all that. You got to look at the front.
Right.
It's probably a 20,000-piece puzzle, but, man, I can do it.
Yeah, no, I want to sit with him too, man. I'll be right there. I think I can follow, and I don't sound stupid, but I definitely want to know his mindset, you know?
Man, I'm sure he's used to, I like it. He's seen us from the beginning. I'm sure he's used to what us being stupid looks like. I mean, I used to be like, Zach, you got to know really nice. No, really.
I couldn't, if I had the amount of love and power he has right now, dog, I don't know, man. I'll probably be like Frodo when he put on the ring, dog. I'll probably fuck that shit up, you know?
Yeah.
I'll be fucking all the bitches on Vero.
So I guess this isn't making the cut.
And on that case, I get we are now 1 hour 57 minutes. any last words, Jeff?
Well, if you can sit through a podcast from Go Deep, then I'm sure you can make it through the whole 214 minutes.
Yeah, definitely. Tomorrow's Christmas Eve. There's nobody working. They can listen to this whole thing.
Absolutely. And, you know, I wouldn't be surprised if we get open another present tomorrow.
Yeah, that'd be dope.
I think we've had enough, though. I think he let us open all our presents, get the stockings dumped on the floor. We got it all today, dude.
Yeah, I've heard people say that before, and he still keeps dropping them.
I know he's and to see what he did today with that the group online answer, he very, very engaging tonight. Just unbelievable. I think he's that. Feels that blessed.
Right. Right.
And he shows it. He shows his the love back, and it's just amazing. He is worthy of it.
Yeah, I agree.
Like you said, like you said, you know, what would we have done with that power?
Shit.
And 2 years ago, it would have been, fuck these guys, I got a Ferrari.
Yeah.
I'm going to sell out, you know?
Yeah.
Like, this guy's cruising in an Aston Martin, though.
Yep.
Tells you what's up, man. Tells you everything. You're I got to get out of the world.
You're right. You're right.
Down to earth. It's really cool, man. I'm glad I put all my eggs in his basket, though. He was right all along. And that's what everyone needs to do, is they need to stop believing anything else anyone says if it contradicts him, and focus on that and keep going. Keep pushing.
Exactly.
If he says it's done, it's done. He said it 6 months ago. He said it a year ago. It is done.
Right. I agree 100%.
They're still questioning whether or not who finished the freaking CGI. It's a non-issue.
Right. I 100% agree with that.
I don't really care. I mean, sure, later on, let's, you know, if there needs to be, I mean, there's going to be a huge, dude, can you imagine the story behind the scenes?
Shit. You know what I wanted to do with this shit? With October and all that?
Yeah.
You know?
That's the other chat. That's the other chat I'm in that hasn't panned out yet.
Yeah, I know what you were talking about.
Yeah.
Hopefully one day, man, if it's our destiny, we get that shit done.
Well, I don't know if it's mine or not. But I hope whoever gets the honor is loyal.
Right. Right.
That's all that I care about.
Right. It's been a great...
Hell, I'd probably fuck it up.
No, you won't, man.
I probably wouldn't. I'd probably work 30 hours a day on it.
I think it's going to happen, man. It's, you know, all of our dreams have been, shit, I didn't think we'd be this far, dog, you know?
You know, there was a certain time where it all happened for me, where I believed everything. And I'm starting to see people have that epiphany. And I think it starts with squelching voices that are detrimental to the cause.
Yep. Now you see what I was doing.
I know it, man. You were the first one. Well, Vinaldo did it, but you kind of took it to another level. I mean, you went to Vero with it, and everyone was afraid to do that. You know, I was kind of afraid to share myself on Vero too.
Yeah.
There was a time where I thought I had to be a certain way.
Right.
And then I knew that was just, that just needed to be myself, you know?
Right.
And if people like you, then they like you. If they don't, then it is what it is.
Right. Definitely.
But I don't think I've ever tried to be someone I'm not to try to fit some kind of cookie cutter thing.
Right.
I think if anything, I just backed off a little on who I am.
Yeah, I think I've done that. I've done that too on Vero, but the time with those guys, man, I just, like you said, we had to squash the virus, you know, and
the ants, yeah, getting in the picnic.
I had to spray them bitches up.
You did. You turned on the raid on them. That was wonderful. I like this new analogy.
Yeah, the ants. The ants and bozos.
Ants and bozos.
All right, homie. Well, I'm going to get to editing because I was planning on just editing this shit tomorrow, but I think I got a little juice. I can finish it tonight and have it up first thing in the morning.
Well, you're doing the Lord's work, brother.
And you are the Lord.
People together. What?
I said, and you are the Lord because you're white with the beard.
Well, we know that he was Egypt and all that.
Yeah, yo, 44 is going to be pissed. He was like, the Lord ain't white. What are you talking about?
Shout out to 44.
Yeah, shout out to 44. We know 44. I was just making a joke. We know he's from Egypt or something like that.
Something like that, whatever. Yeah, all the gods are within you, brother.
All right, homie. I will talk to you later. I appreciate this interview. This is great. I mean, we're over 2 hours, so this was a great conversation, bro.
Yeah, it was. It really was.
Till next.
I love you, man.
Love you too, dog. Till next time.
All right. Peace. Next time.